Welcome, everybody. This is the second lecture by Roger Stewart in our 2021 winter school. Roger is, in his own words, he says he's a truant from medicine. Now, I don't know if that means, Roger, that you were a doctor involved in practicing medicine. You are also a truant from academic clinical physiology and commercial business. He now conducts self-funded research and publishes on the history of the Cape and on African cartography. He has a special interest in the Cape's pioneer travelers and scientists, their maps and experiences, but specifically in small and miniature maps of Africa. He represents the International Map Collector Society in South Africa, and he is a member of the Washington Map Society, the Royal Society of Southern Africa, and the Owl Club. Welcome, Roger.
Well, thank you very much for that introduction. And yes, I am. I did once practice medicine, but please don't let anyone fall ill because I haven't been in medicine since, I haven't practiced medicine since 1987. But I do try to keep up to date. So I was asked to deliver a talk on a virtual tour of Cape Town, and this came from earlier discussions. And it's always a difficulty is deciding where should we visit on a tour. And this is a tour of probably about 40, 45 minutes, and it normally takes a day or a couple of days to tour Cape Town. So someone who I've studied a lot is William Birchall. And I'm going to do a virtual tour of Cape Town, the Cape Town that he saw, to the extent that it's possible for us to see what he saw. And that's where I'm going to go today. He is far better known for his long trek all the way through into the Kalahari with excursions near the Vaal, all the way to the Great Fish River and back again. And that took him 4.5 years. And he went entirely on wagon, and there's the interior of his wagon. However, he did spend time in Cape Town. He was in Cape Town for 6 months, 7 months before he departed on his trek, and for 5 months after his return. And just to take you back to about 1810, when he arrived in Cape Town, this is more or less what Cape Town looked like. And this is a model which you can see at the Chavon Battery Museum if you go and visit it. And you can see Cape Town is really very small. There are farms in the areas that we know as Oranjezicht. And this green area here is now the Greenpoint Stadium. And so this is the Cape Town that he arrived at. And he undertook a number of walks between November and June. And when you realize the extension of these walks, you'll understand this was a man who could walk, and he could walk long distances. He went about Lion Mountain twice. He went to the foot of Table Mountain to view Table Bay. He went to Von Kamp's Bay, which is Kamp's Bay as we know it today, Paradise, which is in Newlands. He climbed to the top of Table Mountain, and he went to Munich's Bridge, which is not known today, and I'll show you where Munich's Bridge is, across the Vriesbeek River. And he went to Constantia and the Kirstenbosch areas, both before he went on his trek and afterwards. And afterwards, he also, sorry, as a spelling mistake there, he went to Devil's Mountain. So he arrived at the jetty, and this jetty, which was opposite the Buren Bastion of the castle, and the area where they anchored is near today's Civic Center. And he then went from the jetty. He traveled along Strand Street, and here is a panorama from about the same time. And Strand Street, you can see, was here is the jetty at the bottom left, and here is Strand Street, and this is the parade. And he went to, and he took in the view. He was really very much attracted by it. And he said that at first no object attracted my notice till I sufficiently admired the amphitheater and here is the amphitheatre of mountains in which the town reposes, with the charm of novelty which casts an agreeable hue over the whole scene. Whatever I beheld seemed to present itself as a subject for my future investigation. And this panorama was painted by Josephus Jonas, not Jones, about 1808, maybe 1810, and it can be seen at the Rupert Museum in Stellenbosch. And you'll notice here that there is a structure you might be able to see that is no longer present. And this is one of the first historical monuments really for us to recall or to know about, which we can't see today. And in the middle of the grand parade, roughly, and I'll show just now, but this is roughly where the Golden Acre is today, here is the castle, was this imposing structure here, which was a fountain and at the bottom of the Farsha River, which distributed water to the people of Cape Town. And this was built by Tybalt in around about 1808. Well, it was certainly present in 1808, because this is when this picture was painted. And it supplied water to the townsfolk who would come to here and a couple of other springs. But in 1813, while Birchall was on his trek, it was demolished because the water supply to Cape Town had become reticulated with iron and lead, well, lead-lined iron pipes that had been imported from England. And unfortunately, this is something of which nothing remains at all. It was just entirely demolished and it has been lost to history, apart from in one or in this picture. And this is the castle you can see on the left. Here is the location of the original old Cape Fort, the wooden mud fort. And this is more or less where the where that fountain stood, and it's above where Wagenaar's reservoir, which was built by the VOC, was established, and the ruins of that can be seen at below if you go into the basement section of the Golden Acre. He then walked up Strand Street and went as far as the Lutheran Church complex, where he stayed with the Reverend Hesse, who was the minister responsible for it, and he stayed in the parsonage. This is the parsonage, and you'll see that this is what it looked like, and you can see the spire is quite different from what it is in the much later. This is a photograph here in 1910. It was in the 1800s that this facade was changed, the one that Anrith had had developed. And he stayed with Reverend Hess, and it was from there that he did went on a number of walks. And here is the Lutheran Church complex as it was roughly in 2015, a few years after I gave this talk for the first time. And here is the barracks development, the controversial development, which has been done above the other building here, which was a warehouse. It had been a hospital for sick sailors, and it had a number of different functions. And from the church, he decided to take a walk along Lion Mountain, and he took a walk up towards what we know as Kloof Neck today, and he went past this structure here, which he describes in detail, or in some detail anyway, as the theatre, which is situated in the Boer Plain. This was known as the Boer Plain, and it was seldom used, because it depended chiefly on the performance of amateurs. And since his arrival, another Boer market, BOER market at the southern entrance to Cape Town had been established, and that is on the site of today's Good Hope Centre. And this is a picture of the theatre, and here it is today. It's St. Stephen's Church, and here is the so-called Boer Plain, which is now a parking area. Now, when he went walking around Lion Mountain, it's useful for us to remember that on the Atlantic coast side, there were all of two structures. Here is a road that did exist. So this is the Atlantic Ocean. Here's Lion's Head that goes towards Signal Hill. And this is the cottage of a Mr. Beck, which must have had a beautiful view. It was round about Bantry Bay. And over here is the Society House, which I'll explain a little bit later. And this is the view that Burchell painted in 1810. And here is the view today. This was done from the sea. This is taken from the air. And you can see there have been some minor changes. As he said here, he was overwhelmed by this botanic garden. And there he's referring to the mountain itself, which he said was like a botanic garden, had been neglected and left to grow in a state of nature. And he was just so enthralled by the riches of the Cape Botany. And he just could never get over the fact that when he would walk in 100 square meters or 100 square yards, he would see greater variety of plants than in the whole of England. On another of his walks, he went past what was known as the Kerk Plain, and he would have gone past the Grote Kerk, and here's a picture from 1824, what it looked like, and it was very similar in 1810. And here is the slave lodge, and if we look at it today, that is what we see, and it's quite useful to remember that this used to be a road with people riding in their horse carts. He then went to an area above Table Mountain, and it looks like a flat area here, and today it's rather difficult to perceive where this could be. And it would seem to be, judging from all the work that I have done so far, that this was in the area of Mill Street, not far from the garden center, where there is a relatively level area. And this was the view of Table Bay that he saw, and he had a picnic over there. And this is Burchell himself. He always, apart from one self-portrait, he always paints himself from behind. And this is him doing his painting. And this is the same view today from the Mill Street area, looking out towards Table Bay. As you can see, it has changed quite a lot. He also climbed Table Mountain with a quite an interesting party of people, and that in itself is an interesting story. And when he was up on Table Mountain, he always took his drawing and painting materials with him. Here he painted the scene. We can see, obviously, this is Lion Mountain, and there is Table Bay, and there is the small village of Cape Town before him. And there is a similar view, and you will notice that I've tried to replicate the views to the extent that it's possible with modern photographs taken today. So this is what it looks like today, and that was just over 200 years ago. He then undertook another walk, and this was to Camps Bay. He was in the city of in the Cape Town. He was at the Lutheran Church, and he walked out past the cemeteries, the slave cemeteries, and over here we can still see remnants of the original wall of the around the cemetery in Prestwich Road. Went past Greenpoint, and then walked all the way through past the Society House, which is over here, and into Camps Bay, where there was a single house, no other residents at all. When he was walking past from the city towards Greenpoint, he passed the Amsterdam Battery, which was then standing. And here is a depiction from the VOC paintings that are at the National Archives in the Netherlands, of the Amsterdam Battery that wasn't only a battery, but fulfilled a number of different functions. It had been a hospital, it had been barracks, and it had served a number of functions, but in the 1900s, it was dynamited by the city. Here it is in 1890, all that remains of it. Here is, obviously, this is now very close to where there is a petrol station if you enter the V&A waterfront. Here is the original construction from 100 years earlier. And in 2014, all that we could see was this part of the round structure, that you can see this curved structure here. That was all that remained of the battery that extend into what was then the parking area. There used to be a Ferris wheel here, if you remember that, for those of you who are around in Cape Town then. And this has been repurposed, this whole area. And here is that same walled structure over here. And this is now known as the battery center, meaning the Amsterdam battery. So this has been completely repurposed. And this is what he walked past in 1810. And when he went on his way to Camps Bay, he went past, this is number, this is another another battery, that's probably Ford Vineyard over there. And here was a small flay, which was the Greenpoint flay. And that is at a somewhat different elevation. Here is what the Greenpoint flay looks like today. And in 1910, this is what it looked like. It was a flay that increased in size in winter. You can see people canoeing here. They also had yachting races over, at that time. And here I've tried to simulate the same view. You can see this is fairly similar view taken from a similar angle. And this is now a beautiful park near the soccer stadium, or near the Cape, the Greenpoint Stadium, that is fed water from the spring from below Table Mountain. That in itself is another story. So we can see that it became rather unattractive, but it has more recently been returned to some sort of state of nature, and we have water once there again. Now, he then walked all the way through from Greenpoint through to Seapoint, and he went as far as the Seapoint contact, which is the at the end of the beach road. And for those of you who have not been there before, it is really worth a visit. And then to turn around and look towards towards Lion's Head and imagine that here was this country club. This is what it looked like in 1760s. For the VOC and certain burghers who had a good relationship with them. And this has undergone quite a significant transformation. 100 years later, it became Seapoint House, a hotel. In 1880, it was then the Wentworth Hotel. It then became the Queen's Hotel. And you can see here, there's a very similar positions. We've been able to get these photographs. These two obviously are a little bit before my time, but managed to get hold of those. And here is the Queen's Hotel from 1930, now dramatically changed. And I certainly remember the Southern Sun President Hotel when I was a medical student. Once again, we can see that the background is the same. And that is that same hotel today. So this rather interesting, and when Birchall was there, rather derelict farm and country club turned into a prominent hotel, and it is very close to the Seapoint contact, which is an interesting geological phenomenon that I'm not going to discuss any further. Now, while Birchall was away, and not good, I just must show a map, but the details of this map are really not that important. But Tybalt, who built that beautiful fountain, also was the Surveyor General for a time, and he produced a general plan of Cape Town in the years of 1812 to 1813. And here we have the eastern side of Table Mountain. This is the main road as we know it today. It hasn't changed very much, going all the way, but on a different route, all the way through to Kirstenbosch. This section is obviously very much different, but right up to here, that road still exists. And in fact, the road continues all the way through here, where it crosses the Deep River near the Three Arts Theatre that was, and that was an important halfway stop. And then we have the Liesbeek River running along here, and then it's joined by the Black River, and it enters in Paarden Eiland. And you will see that Albert Road existed then, and it continued over here as Malta Road. And we can see that that connecting road that many of us know existed at that time. And this was Roodebloem. Of interest, which I'm going to come back to later, is that in doing this survey, you can see some faint little arrows. There were he used as key identification points a number of the windmills along the Cape Flats. And here is a drawing of this. And he walked from the castle, and in this particular journey of his, he went past Trafalgar Park, as it is known today, and then it was the French line, and there was a toll that had to be paid. The French line was a defense line. The defense line actually went from the castle all the way to Fort Knocker, which no longer exists. I refer to that again just now. And then vertically up towards, at right angles, towards Devil's Peak. And this area today is Trafalgar Park. And this was the French line, and that's where the toll was. He continued along here, went past Zonnebloem, Roodebloem, and we'll discuss some of the, I'll take you to some of the places that he visited en route. One of the places that he passed was Zonnebloem, which was a farm, and which in the 1850s became the famous Zonnebloem, some people say infants, but it became the famous Zonnebloem College. And there is that same house. It still exists. Here it is, a more recent photograph. And you can see it in the background, and this is a Google Earth view. And that still exists today, but clearly it's not a farm. A lot of the space is still open, but that has a different reason. It's got nothing to do with farmland. This was really part of District 6, which has been abandoned. And there are a lot of informal, wouldn't call them huts, but there's an informal settlement very close to it. When he was walking along the main road, he went past what today is Spring Street. And I don't know how many of you know where Spring Street is, but it is at the western end of Woodstock, and it is where Woodstock started, because there was a spring here. And why it is important is this 500-year-old Milkwood tree, which is known as the Treaty Tree. And it is very close to the point, to the place where a number of Spanish visitors in the early 1600s engaged the locals and were roundly thrashed and left. And so this has had a long history. It's obviously seen a lot. And there are a number of myths about what happened here. But what we do know definitely happened was that at Treaty House, right next to Treaty Tree, the British, formerly the Dutch, formal the Dutch Batavian government, formally surrendered to the British and after their invasion at the Battle of Blouberg. And this is the Treaty House. Here is a photograph of it, and I think this is by Elliot. This was around about 1910, and here it is today. Unfortunately, this was demolished to make way for a really ugly factory. The ugly factory was over here. It's been replaced by a more modern building. And the Treaty Tree used to be in a little park known as Treaty Park. It had a plaque, but the plaque was made out of bronze, so it disappeared very quickly. And this was a neglected park. And when I first came here around about 2012, 2013, I had discussion with the locals. They didn't know that there'd been a spring. This was just a place where the children used to play. And they used to have a little swing from it over here. You can see part of it. And they knew nothing about the history because the information had been stolen. What has now happened is that this new building has been erected, and the Treaty Tree Park has been incorporated in the grounds, and this tree is now conserved in the grounds of this private property. After passing the Treaty Tree, he went past the toll gate, and this is now the toll gate terminus. And I wonder how many people who've gone by bus know why this was called the toll gate terminus. And we now know that this was an important toll for people who wanted to come into Cape Town. They had to go past here. They came from more or less the Coburg interchange. They had to go past here, and if they wanted to go out, that was the only route that they could take. And this was a toll. And if we look at this, this is in the traffic light. This is the bottom of Searle Street. This is Main Road going here. This is Searle Street coming down from the mountain. This is Trafalgar Park. And here is the redoubt, which is known as Central, or the French Line redoubt, which was built in 1780. And the remains are still here from that important defensive position. And if one looks towards the east from here, we can see this building, and beyond that was Fort Knocker. Now, Fort Knocker, this is the only picture I've been able to find of it, was in Woodstock. Here was the Altona farm and the farmhouse. And Fort Knocker was demolished to make way for progress. The railway line that had been built and was being built in the 1870s extended from the harbour all the way through to Wellington at that stage. And they decided to demolish this structure in order to make way for the railway line. And it all remained for quite a number of years was a sentry's pillar box, which was then moved to the Ezekiel Museum. And this was the old, very much converted and changed, and it's changed again, the old Altona Hotel, which was on the site of the Altona farm. He also walked past Roodebloem, which I showed earlier, and here is the old homestead, very much like Birchall would have seen it around about 1804. He was there in 1810, but is not sure when this second story was added. And here it is today, and here is the Roodebloem Manor, which is now the head offices of the King James Group. Very famous for the work that it has done, for a lot of its advertising work that it's done. And the Roodebloem homestead is of interest because virtually all the traffic in and out of Cape Town went past it. And it was the first home to have a telegraph, and that connected directly to the castle so that information could be sent through to the authorities on who was about to enter Cape Town. Now, I mentioned that the map by Tybalt, and I've just taken a small part of it here, was drawn between 1812 and 1813. And I mentioned that he used as important points in his survey the windmills of Cape Town. And this here is the Oude Moerland, but it's actually the Nieuwe Moerland. It's the mill that is in today's Alexandria Institute, where you can go and have your COVID tests and COVID vaccination done. And here is the Nieuwe Moerland, which no longer exists. And one of the tasks that I've often thought of asking my surveyor friends to do is to identify exactly where this stood, because those foundations should still be there. And here is one of the Salt River, and here's another Salt River windmill. And so I went in search of these. And here is the windmill along the Salt River Mill off Malta Road. This is Malta Road over here. And it has been replaced by a modern mill. It's a premier grain mill, an electric driven mill. And we can see that it's along the very much, and I've been fortunate in being able to get virtually the same profile of the mountain here, obstructed by this tree. But these windmills were very important beacons at that time for people who wanted to find their way around Cape Town. Now, I mentioned Munich's bridge. This is the Liesbeek River, and this is a wooden bridge that was constructed, and I've been unable to find quite a lot of much information about it. There's very little information about it. And I tried to find out exactly where was it. And so I spent a lot of time walking along the banks of the Liesbeek, trying to get a picture that replicated the view that Birchall had. One of the advantages of following Birchall is that he was an exceptionally good draftsman and his perspectives were excellent. And so we can see here Devil's Peak, and we can see the eastern edge of Table Mountain, and there it is, the western edge, and here is Lion's Head, Well, lion's head is obstructed, but if you look very carefully, and you can see it much better on a larger image, here is the same image of Table Mountain, and you can just see it peeping over here. It looks far better in the picture than in the photograph. And this is very close to the entrance to the to the Falkenberg Hospital. This is the bridge that goes over it, and I wonder if this is actually on the same location, but it must be very close to where Munich's bridge is. And that was an area that Burchell explored, and he was enthralled by the botanical riches that he found, but he also made the observation that the Cape Flats were a problem, because at that time he had observed that in order to find firewood, which was in short supply, the locals would dig the local vegetation up and pull them out by their roots. And he had made a very specific proposal as to what vegetation or what plants could be planted there in order to prevent this from becoming a safety, becoming a sandy wasteland, which it did. On his way back from the from his excursion along the Liesbeek, he went past the Drie Koppen, and this is one of the first taverns in Cape Town, and that is on the corner of, this is Main Road, and this is the road through to Mowbray from the Mostert's Mill, which we all know has been severely damaged, and that structure has disappeared. And this is now a satellite office of the University of Cape Town. He then also walked past the Rustenburg, which was another important treaty location, because it was here that the defeat of the British, of the Dutch, was signed in 1795 after the Battle of Blouberg. And what remains of this building is incorporated in Rustenburg Junior School. On a further walk, when he went on his way through to Kirstenbosch, he went past Rokoop Road. And a number of you may know Rokoop Road, because the corner of Rokoop and Main Road, there is a well-known, there's been a restaurant there, I think, ever since I was a student, which is in the late 60s and early 70s. And it is still a restaurant. Or hopefully it still is now after these shutdowns. But there was a very large manor there, which has subsequently been demolished. But what is really of interest as well is a bridge known as the Westervoort Bridge, of which one is completely oblivious when driving along the main road. So this is the main road of Claremont, and this is the walkway and the road that takes one to Newlands Rugby Stadium, as it was. And here is the Liesbeek River. This is Dean Street, if those of you who are trying to orientate yourselves. And there is a bridge here. And part of the bridge that Tybalt built in 1810 is under the road. And so if you walk down here, there is a little bridge that goes across the Liesbeek. And if you walk there, you can actually see the remains of Tybalt's bridge and the main road now, when you're not even aware that there is a bridge when you drive there, is visible. And there have been some wonderful paintings of women washing clothes in the rocky area over here, and they used the rock to scrub the clothes on. And so a very interesting bit of history relating to that map as well, but something that people didn't know Tybalt for was that he built bridges. And this was an important bridge for traveling to the south in order to get towards Simonstown. He then walked up towards Paradise, which is in the Newlands Forest, and went past the Paarpenboom homestead area, and also past Newlands House, which no longer exists. That was in Lakai Road, and that burnt down in the 1970s. It was a restaurant at the time. And then also walked past the spring that is off Spring Street in off Kildare Road in Newlands, and it is this spring, and it's the Papenboom, which are associated with the first breweries of Cape Town. And here are the ruins, it is thought, of the house in Paradise and some modern reconstruction by an artist. He then proceeded all the way through to Kirstenbosch, and I really include this not because it's a picture by him, this is a very old photograph to remind us of the silver trees and where Witteboom, if we remember the name Witteboom, where it gets its name from. I've noticed that a lot of, in speaking to locals, very few realize that the Witteboom actually refers to the silver trees. And he meant to visit Witteboom, a name which, with great propriety, is received on account of numerous plantations of lark Witteboom or silver trees, which grow about it. The native trees of the stations, the only part of the colony where they grow. And as most of you probably know, that this tends to grow at a very specific altitude. And there was a forest of these silver trees. And he proceeded from Constantia, went over the Weinberg Hill, and then went through to Kirstenbosch. And although he was an exceptional artist, and he said that it is the most picturesque scenery in the vicinity, the beauties here displayed to the eye could scarcely be represented by the most skillful pencil. And although he had material with him, he elected not to draw it. He just felt it was probably the most beautiful scene in the peninsula. But what was interesting is that Birchall not only made a couple of horticultural suggestions. One was to plant indigenous vegetation on the Cape Flats to prevent them from becoming a sandy wasteland, but then also said that if in the vicinity of Cape Town, a well-ordered botanic garden of sufficient extent were established for the purpose of receiving plants collected in the more distant parts of the colony, the sum of money required for maintaining it would be but trifling in comparison with the advantage. It took over 100 years from that suggestion before a botanic garden was built, and it was built or constructed at Kirstenbosch, the most wonderful scene. Now, Birchall was in Cape Town for 6 months before he departed. He went on his trek from June 1811, returned April 1815, and remained there until October 1815. Unfortunately, his book does not include any information about his return journey from the Kalahari. That itself is a story in itself. But he, like Josephus Jonas before him, and also Lady Anne Barnard, sat atop the buildings that existed between Strand Street and the sea. That is where today's Cape Town station is. And he drew a panorama of which three painted, one unpainted, and what? And there was a fifth lost panel. These are at the Museum Africa. And you can't see the detail here. He identified every single one of these houses, and he identified who the occupants were. And unfortunately, that list has now gone. Now, he spent time between April and October. We know little about what he did from the letters that he wrote. We know he tended to a lot of the business after having been away for 4 years, and in preparing for the returning, or the return, or taking his massive collection of over 50,000 items to London. And he also took time to draw this scene. Now, the best description of Birchall's time in Cape Town and the walks that he went on and his preparations, his meticulous preparations for his journey, are in his book, Birchall's Travels. And his book, it's next year, is the bicentenary of the publication of his book. Unfortunately, his book, if you had to get the original, it's going to cost a lot of money. A good copy costs about $9,000 to $10,000 today. And that is because only 500 copies of the second volume and 700 of the first were published, and many were damaged when people who were so enthralled by the beautiful illustrations removed them and the map. And so the book, although not exceptionally rare, is available but at a huge price. Sue Buchanan, sorry, I forgot to put down the name of the authors here. Sue Buchanan, who died a few years ago, wrote a wonderful book, Birchall's Travels, The Life, Art, and Journeys of William Birchall. And in this, she describes a lot of his life, including all the way from his time in the UK, his time in St. Helena, in Southern Africa, including his duration of his visit in, his stay in Cape Town, and his return. And that book is accessible. It's out of print now, although you may find copies. Otherwise, they're available at secondhand bookshops or on the internet. Birchall's original book is available, fortunately, online for those of you who are able to read books online. And I will be sending a PDF version of all these of this presentation to you. And so if any of you would like to read his book, and it is probably one of the most stunning books that anyone could read, that is, you will be able to visit it on the internet. And then in 2012, in preparation for the bicentenary of, in celebration of the bicentenary of William Birchall's visit to South Africa, Brian Warner and I wrote an article on William Birchall, the polymath, the multi-skilled polymath, and that is also available on the internet for anyone who would like to read it. So thank you very much for your attention, and I'm quite happy to take any questions that there may be. I must say I found it really interesting trying to follow Birchall, and what was really interesting was to try and get the same views today that from the positions where he saw them 200 years ago.
Hi, this is Mary Grace. I was wondering if you had suggestions. I mean, this just made me want to go out and explore these places. And I was wondering if you could talk about what are some good sort of walks or excursions where we can go and find some of these places for ourselves.
Yeah, well, I must be honest that only one section of all of this presentation is in a book that I wrote, and it's not going to be in the second edition. What I'm going to do is to send you the slides, and what I have done, and I will review it. I actually have written this up, but not published it. So what I will do is I'm going to go through that, and it does give some indication and give street names, but I need to review it. So if you, I will send the publication, but I undertake, and I'll get UCT somewhere. Zuleika, maybe you can remind me. I must actually send you what I wrote up on this, because that would probably help you to find those places.
Okay, thanks very much.
Have you ventured out of Cape Town, say the northern suburbs?
To what? To do the presentation?
I think in terms of historical landmarks, I think she means are there any historical landmarks outside of Cape Town, outside of central Cape Town?
Yeah, those are written up in his book on his journey. He went across the what he called the Sandy Downs through to what today would be Paro Valley near Tigerberg Hospital, where there used to be a small lake, and then went through to Pampoenkraal, which is today's Durbanville, where there is a very large spring and there was an outspan. And on his way back, he went to Harderkraalkie, and Harderkraalkie is an outspan. It's called Harderkraalkie because it was the kraal, or it was the outspan, that was the last one on the hard road, and thereafter you had to take the sandy road through to Cape Town. And that is directly opposite the medical school at Tigerberg. So those are key places that he saw. He also did go on a journey to Genadendal by horse, and he visited Meerlust and a couple of other farms along the way. And that journey is recorded, including over the mountain. He went over the Cantal, the Hottentots Holland Kloof Mountain, Hohoek, and then all the way through to Genadendal. And part of that story, his return journey, I related in my presentation on Monday. Okay, I can notice a few questions here. When was the first observatory built? The Royal Observatory, you're really going to test my knowledge of history, but it was, if I remember correctly, it was roughly in the, it was about the 1840s, may have been a little bit earlier, and that is on the site of the current observatory, and that is very close to Munich's bridge that I talked about. So if you cross the road there from observatory, you can go into it, and they do have, if I remember correctly, you can go on tours there.
Now, as a question, Roger, can we still see the old slave graveyard? Can the old slave...
You cannot. The graveyard isn't there, but there is an ossuary, which is a rather morbid, which is a name for a rather morbid collection of the bones that were collected when there was construction done. That whole area is actually just all about graveyards and graveyards that were dug up. Tybalt's grave was at the corner of Strand Street and Buitenpracht, and that was built up, and his grave was apparently moved, or he was apparently moved to the Maitland graveyard, but his headstone disappeared. That has never been found. And then there were a number of graves of slaves, and although the graveyard itself is gone, if you drive along Prestwich Road, and in that area, you will see some lower parts of walls which are constructed from the materials, from stones that came from the Strand Street, from the stones from the Strand Street area, and they are still visible, but the bones that were collected are in the ossuary off Prestwich Road. Hope that answers that question. So no, there are no graves that I know of, but every now and again, when there is any kind of construction done in the area between Buitenkracht Street and Greenpoint, it is very likely that that bones will be found of people who were buried there, not all slaves, but it still happens from time to time. And then there are as a whole archaeological process that has to take place.
Question from Mel. I don't know if you've seen it. Well, it's just a comment, really. He says, so interesting, our Irish ancestors lived on Roodebloem Street after 1812.
Yeah, and of course, the Irish ancestors, or the Irish, was quite interesting. There was a large contingent that came to Cape Town. They landed at Mossel Bay and thought they were going to go to the area around about Algoa Bay, but they were sent to Clan William. And I've given a presentation before on that, the Irish settlers who settled there, and a couple actually settled near the Rafis on their end as well. And that's a whole story all of its own.
Hi. Fantastic talk. You mentioned, or the write-up mentioned, a dragon tree in Kalk Bay.
Yes. Okay. That was mentioned in another trip, in another presentation, not this one. There is a dragon tree in Kalk Bay. You send me an email, I'll tell you how to get there.
Okay, thank you.
just send it to me, because I can't remember the name of the road offhand. I could tell you how to get there.
Okay.
But it is there, and there used to be a dragon tree above the Timeball, next to the Timeball Tower, above Ferryman's Pub, and that blew down in a storm. It was damaged, and that has an interesting history. And that, if you send me an email, I'll send you something on that.
Terrific. And the various books that are still available, please, if you could give me a note on those, or direct me to a website.
Books on?
On your talk that you've drawn.
Oh, yeah, those are on the last slide.
Okay.
So that slide I'm going to be sending through to, I mentioned it at the end of my talk, I'm going to be sending a PDF of these slides, and you'll be able to see it there. And you'll be able to find the websites and the web links and be able to follow that up.
Terrific, thank you.
Roger, there's a question from Imgard. Who was Ruland Street named after?
Haven't a clue.
I would have to look that
Sorry up. About that, but I know what I don't know, and I'm quite happy to admit it. And if you find out, please let me know. I have no idea where Ruland Street came from. But as an aside, it's really, there's a lot to be learned by looking at the street names, because some of the early surveyors who laid out the roads of Cape Town did their history, and they named a number of them, a number of roads after people who were involved in the early part of the history of the country. So I mentioned Lakai, spelled L-A and then C-A-I-L-L-E in Newlands. He was a visitor to Newlands House and did some really interesting research in South Africa in 1750. And so there are a number of examples of these. And of course, some of these people become notorious because they had various kinds of affiliations which are not acceptable today. And of course, their names are being airbrushed, and we'll possibly lose the knowledge of those people, but for good or for bad. But the street names and their origin is itself a very, very interesting subject.
I wondered if you knew where the name Oranjezicht came from, because I do.
Please tell me.
There was a farm on the slopes higher up on Table Mountain, more or less where above Gardens Centre.
Yeah, Van Bredaar farm.
That's right. And when the lady Van Bredaar looked out, she could see the corner of the castle, which was Oranje.
Aha, so it was from a view of the Oranje Blanje Blow.
Yes, so she called her, that was then called Oranjezicht, because like...
Well, it's interesting because Colonel Gordon lived in Oranjezicht, and it was he who named the Orange River after Oranje as well.
Interesting. Thank you very much for your talk, Roger. Loved it.
Well, I'm pleased. Thank you very much. And thanks to everybody for all the questions.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Goodbye. Bye-bye.